Okay, if you're like me, you've probably banged your head against pandas many times trying to work out the right commands to get the data that you want. Today, I found a really interesting package called PandasAI. And this basically is not a replacement for pandas. It's kind of like an add-on that adds the ability to use a large language model with pandas. And after trying it, I think it's, you know, pretty cool. It's worth having a look at here. So this is the package. You could basically just pip install it and start using it straight away. You will need an OpenAI key if you want to use the OpenAI models for the large language model. It looks like they're adding support for other large language models, although when I tried it in here, that wasn't working for me currently. Anyway, let's jump into the code and have a look at exactly what this can do. Like I said, you just pip install this package and then you can go through. And here I'm basically just bringing in the standard imports. So we're just importing pandas like normal. We're importing this new pandas AI here and the large language models. So it does have support for bringing in StarCoder, Open Assistant, and Google Palm. I didn't have much success with any of the ones apart from OpenAI in this. So this was originally their own demo from the site. I've messed with it quite a bit, so I'll leave in their notes, but I've added a lot more to this as well. So if you go through, you need a data frame to basically edit, and you need to set up your OpenAI key in here as well. Once you've done that, you just instantiate the large language model. And this is very similar to something like LangChain or some of the other sort of things along these lines where you instantiate your large language model. Really what you're creating is a zero-shot React agent here in doing this. And that's also why they've got the .run going on in here. Anyway, you can see from our data up here, so you can see we just come in here, we can basically now ask it a question, which are the five happiest countries? Now, it does take a while to get your answers back from this. I did find that it's not super snappy in the way it's doing. Maybe with local language models, it will be actually a lot better for this eventually. Okay, so once you've set up your key, you're then able to basically just instantiate the large language model. And this is very similar to the way that LangChain does it. And then we're actually, what this is actually doing is also creating like a zero-shot React agent in the background. So once we've got that, we basically then can do our dot run. We pass in the data frame and then we can ask a question from it. So here, based on the data frame that we instantiated up above, I can ask which are the, you know, five happiest countries, and it can go through and tell me, okay, United States, Canada, Australia, United Kingdom, Germany. We can even do things like ask it to plot information. So here's one of the examples they give. Plot the histogram of countries showing each the GDP and using different colors. So they've done that and they've got a nice plot. So I thought, okay, that's interesting, but is this just going to work with sort of histograms? Can we do a pie plot? So I tried my own one, basically plotting a pie chart of countries showing for each the GDP. You can see that it basically is able to do that, and it's told us what it's done as well. So it's given us a conversational answer and the actual plot each time that it does that. So that's pretty cool. And this is where their demo stopped, or actually above this was kind of where their demo stopped. So looking through the docs, though, there's a lot of other things that this can do. Obviously, with pandas, we can bring in a CSV file, an Excel file, a bunch of different types of files. And so here I've brought in the Titanic data set. If we just look at this, is quite a famous data set around different places of just facts and figures from the Titanic, who survived, who didn't. Great data set for trying out new ideas and stuff like that. So here I've brought in that data set as a CSV file. And sure enough, straight away, we can basically ask questions of that. We can ask how many people died, and it will work out what the answers are and give it to us in a conversational format. We can then do things like show me the ratio of males to females that died, and it's able to work that out. Show me what's the average of those who survived. And sure enough, it's given me this. So I went and worked out, okay, what's the pandas for actually doing that? And sure enough, it looks like their answer is correct here. The same for the average of those who died. And we can see that. I checked that in pandas as well. One of the things that they mention is that you can actually get the response back as a data frame. So if you basically pass in is conversational answer equals false and set this to be conversational equals false, sure enough, you'll get a data frame, but actually just as a string. So this is not ideal. So here we've got, please give me a data frame of those whose ticket costs more than £50. And I've passed that back. And when we look at that, looks like a data frame, but it's actually in string format. So when I go just to do, you know, the head of the data frame, I'm not getting that. Now, it could be something that I'm doing wrong. I didn't find anything in the docs for how to fix that. I'll show you a way in a little bit how we could do this, though, using their technique. Okay, once we've done that, we can get answers conversationally. But one of the things that's really useful, too, is we can actually get the code back. So if we set up our large language model to be conversational equals true, verbose equals true, now whenever we pass in show code equals true, we will actually see the generated code and the code that gets run. So here I'm asking, what is the pandas command for the average age of those who died? It basically got this command, right, that we've got there. And we can actually copy and paste this if we wanted to out there. And we can see that then we've got the answer and then we've got the conversational answer. So the verbose shows the structure of how everything goes. It goes to the large language model that generates some code. So what's getting passed to the large language model is not your entire data set. It's just the head of the data. And I'll show you a little bit. You can actually change it so that it's only passing in the column names to there as well. But here, okay, we can basically see the code out that we want. So then I was curious, if I try this with a plot, make a plot of died versus survived for people under 30, sure enough, it gave us the nice plot back. And then we can see the generated code for that plot is import matplotlib. We've got the pandas query there. And then we've got the actual create the bar plot there. This is like an unbelievably cool way to learn pandas and learn things like matplotlib, because you can actually go through and just ask it in natural language what it is that you want, and it will actually write the queries for you, and then you can actually go through and see them. I was curious to see, like, okay, how responsive is this? So I used the same thing, but now I just said, oh, red versus blue at the end, right? To basically show that I wanted a plot of red and blue, not both of them being blue. And sure enough, it got that straight away. It's basically worked out that, okay, died should be red, blue should be survived. And we can see that sure enough, it's even part, it's written out the matplotlib code for doing this really nicely. Again, the conversational answer is there if we wanted to do this as well. I was curious, like, okay, what if we want to do a search through a column for something? So this is one of the pandas commands that often people find frustrating, is how do I do a search in each row of a column for a specific value? So here I've basically asked it, how many people on the Titanic were called Eugene? And sure enough, it basically writes what column to look in, and it's going to be a string that it needs to contain Eugene. And it comes back and it says, okay, there's three here. So this is where I just wanted to show that it doesn't have a memory. So if I ask it, for example, show me their names, it's not going to show me the names of the three people called Eugene. It doesn't remember this particular call that's been run is nowhere in it. So it's a little bit different than the conversational React agents, where perhaps you've got a memory as well. This is more like a zero-shot React agent that's going on here. Now, that said, if we actually put that in the query, show me the full names of people, Eugene, on the Titanic, it's able to then go through, and sure enough, it gives us the three people's names that were there. And we're getting the code for this as well. So going back to our problem of looking at, can we get the data frame out? If I ask the same thing now, and I ask it, okay, give me the code, I can see exactly what the code is for this. And then I can basically just post the code here and, you know, use the code that it generated to basically say, right, it's interesting that it called it DF expensive tickets, which is true. I think before that time, these were certainly expensive tickets, but it basically written out the pandas query there We've saved it back to a new data frame. We can then look at that data frame and see the results in here, which is very useful for this. Next one up is the sort of privacy and enforced mode. So one of the things it can do is you can basically, if you come down here, you can see we can pass in that enforced privacy equals true. So there are a couple of things going on here. If you wanted to just anonymize the data, it has a helper function that does anonymize data. Now you'll see that when I pass in the Titanic thing, it doesn't really anonymize anything. Why is that? So if we come in here and look at their code, we can see that actually what they're doing here is they're going through and looking for things like, is a valid email, is a valid phone number, is a valid credit card, and it will anonymize those things. They've got things up here for doing the anonymization of those. In these, we didn't have any of that. So it didn't actually anonymize it. Not to worry though, because if the thing that we're really just concerned about is it only ever sends the head of the data to the language model. So if we put on this enforced privacy equals true, it will no longer even send the head. It will just send the column names to the large language model. So that you can see when we're doing this now, it's just literally sending the column names and it's using that for getting back the searches and stuff here. So in this mode, your data should be pretty safe that it's just staying locally and really just the column names are what's being sent to the cloud for this. But play with it yourself and go and check the code for yourself. I think things like that, you should always check yourself. Anyway, going through the privacy mode, it seems to be able to generate out results and stuff like that. But we can do things like ask it for, here I'm asking for the names of females over 55 who survived. None of these names have been to the large language model. It's just basically the large language model has generated out the Python to filter the data frame for this particular stuff. So overall, I would say this is a very cool package for doing stuff. Now, I mentioned that they've got Starcoder and Palm in there. Even when I tried these with my API keys in there, at the moment I couldn't get them to work, but that could be that the package is just not ready for it yet. It also could be, for example, that the Hugging Face API is not returning, or these models are not returning something in the right format for them to be able to pass out. So I'm not sure. Their response here would be great if they told us, like, okay, what actually the error is in that. Overall, though, this is a great package. I think it's really cool. It's fantastic if you're just learning Pandas for the first time and you want to be able to practice to work out how to do things. This is a really cool way to get the code and learn how to do it yourself. And if you've got big data sets and you just want to set it up for someone to do queries who doesn't know Pandas, this is also really useful for that. And from what I can see, this package is still, you know, quite new. My guess is that they may add more to it and it will probably get better over time. So check it out, Pandas AI. I will put the links in the description as always. If you've got questions, please put them in the comments below. As always, if you found this useful, please click like and subscribe. I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.